The Mozarts, Who They Were. Written by Diego Minoia. Translated by Dina Marzullo. Narrated by Nicole Halton. Published by Tech Time. The Mozarts, Who They Were. A family on the quest of a European triumph. Travels, music, encounters, and interesting facts. The historical, sociological conditions, the family, the childhood and the adolescence of Wolfgang Amadeus. Volume 1, 1747 to 1763. A note to the reader. Throughout the book, some parts of the text have been highlighted in gray. These have been included to give further information and in-depth explanation to broaden the understanding of the topic being discussed. There is no harm in passing over these segments to avoid interrupting the narrative related to the Mozart family. You may wish to reread them later at your leisure. I hope you enjoy these brief parentheses as a contribution to each situation that has been described in its historical and social context. Introduction. Why this book? Because it has never been written. For years, I had been looking for a book about the Mozart family with these characteristics. Having never found one, as an author of several books, I decided to write it. There are dozens of books published on Mozart. Some are biographies of Amadeus. Others are detailed and technical musical analyses of his compositions, and a few are a blend of biographical and musical analysis. This book is different from all the others, as the reader will realize from the first pages. To begin with, we will be talking about the entire Mozart family, not just Wolfgang. There is no musical analysis of the compositions, and the biography was written principally from the information drawn from the most direct and reliable source, the Mozartian epistolary. It is rich in subject matter that is not present in other publications on the Mozarts. Information about the epoch in which they lived, their way of thinking and living, interesting facts about events and situations of which they were the protagonists, etc. The objective of this labor of love is to offer a new instrument, less specialistic and certainly not musicological, but with a wealth of information extracting acquired facts that will allow us to completely lose ourselves in the way of life of the mid to late 1700s. I hope that I have been successful in personifying the Mozarts without downplaying the individual. My aim is to display the evidence with the simplicity and clarity of my decades of interest in Amadeus, Leopold, Nannerl, and the thousands of characters with whom they came into contact. Right from the beginning, my intention was to write a book that would be interesting and pleasurable to read with ease and entertainment for musicians who don't always find informative and specialized publications of detailed study, which offers a better understanding of the context in which Mozart lived, as well as for music lovers who will become acquainted with Mozart as a human rather than the Salzburg genius high on his pedestal, as is often the case. All will be discussed without the long digressions of a critique, but rather with the affinity and affection of which the Mozarts are deserving. What they contributed to mankind far outweighs what they received in return. I will tell you what the Mozarts were truly like, how they lived and how they thought during the 18th century, with the addition of interesting facts relative to situations or matters where they are pertinent to the reader related to the Mozarts in Salzburg, while they were on their European tour and during the three times they traveled to their beloved Italy. In Volume 1, we will be looking at the period dating from 1747 to 1775. Nearly 30 years that consisted of the formation of the Mozart family, the birth of their children, the early sojourns from Salzburg that served to introduce the child prodigies to society, the grand European tour, the three journeys to Italy, and the final attempts in Vienna and Munich by Wolfgang, accompanied by his father. After this period, Amadeus traveled alone, with the exception of a brief initial journey with his mother between Munich and Paris, where she died. He then relocated definitively to Vienna, where he married, concluding his artistic and human parabola in 1791. As a result, the period following 1777, Amadeus returned to a new phase of his life that went beyond his range, which we will talk about in the next volume. The reader who is interested in this book can choose, based on his or her preference, between the ebook version and the printed hard copy, both available in two separate volumes. Part 1. Salzburg and the Mozart Family. The story of the events linked to the Mozart family could best be described by borrowing the subheading from Don Giovanni, a playful drama. An oxymoron which I believe entertained Amadeus Mozart, who adored a good play on words, and which, undoubtedly, is well suited to the intrigue of the protagonist's role of seducer in the opera. The definition could also be adapted to the above-mentioned Mozartian parable, or possibly even more appropriately adapted to the reversal of terms, defining the journey among the world of the Mozart family as a dramatic comedy. The early years, while not easy, were certainly joyous and rich in satisfaction for the prodigious young Wolfgang, shared with his sister Maria Anna, known as Nannerl. They enjoyed the favor of concerts at the important European courts, compliments and gifts from reigning monarchs and from the Pope, admission to prestigious musical academies, Bologna, Verona, honors, knight to the Order of the Golden Spur, granted by Pope Clement XIV, adventurous journeys full of interesting encounters, and the discovery of the world beyond the confines of the small principality of Salzburg. The entire family participated, at least during the early years, in the tours that would launch the prodigious brother and sister, which included lengthy European trips through Germany, Holland, Belgium, France, England, and Switzerland. Only on the three tours to Italy was Wolfgang chaperoned alone by his father Leopold, who had decided to complete the education of his only son in order to prepare him for a career as a composer, accompanying him to drink directly from the spring of the music of that epoch, Italy. Adventures and travels were undertaken with high hopes, with curiosity and open ears, to listen, comprehend, and assimilate the music, styles, and the trends that were to transform this young phenomenon into a musical giant. Not everything, however, went as hoped, for a sequence of events gradually transformed things from a joyous comedy into a drama. After his great successes were underway in Wolfgang's final years, during the period when he was searching for affirmation in Vienna, the empire's capital, an advancing movement of removal began of the Salzburg musician by the fashionable and superficial Viennese intellectuals, an attitude that most certainly created feelings of bitterness and disappointment in the musician and the man. We will talk about all this in due time, as well as Mozart's music. I do believe that in order to truly know and understand an artist, it is necessary to learn about the places where he spent his time, the way he lived and thought during his era, who he encountered, and the ideas that helped shape him. Of course, even without any knowledge of his life, we can still enjoy Mozart's compositions, but we risk limiting our comprehension of their musical range. The musician without the man in his entirety, of which places, people, and ideas contributed so much. We will, therefore, begin at the beginning. Salzburg, the city that was first the cradle to his art, and later a prison, as perceived by the Mozarts. Salzburg, where it all began. Our story begins, inevitably, in Salzburg. This beautiful town is now Austrian, but in Mozart's epoch it was part of the Bavarian territory, spread out along the Salzach River. 27th January 1756, Johannes Chrysostomus, feast day of this saint, Wolfgangus, his maternal grandfather's name, Theophilus, his godfather's name, Mozart, was born. The name Theophilus, from the Greek Theophilos, friend of God or he who loves God, was soon transformed into Amadeus and later at times charmingly shortened to Amadei. In letters from his father, there is occasional reference to the German version, Gottlieb, as well as the affectionate nickname of Wolferl. At that time, Salzburg, comprised of 16,000 inhabitants, was the small capital of one of the many princedoms that were part of the Holy Roman Empire of the Germanic nations, a federation of independent states, some of which were governed by secular sovereignty and others by a prince-bishop, all of which recognized supremacy to the emperor. The prince-bishop of Salzburg was the Primas Germaniae law and leader of the Bavarian bishopric, So, to be exact, the highly acclaimed, by the Austrians, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart was actually born German of Bavaria. He himself confirms this, as well as his father Leopold, who was born German of Augsburg, as can be seen in the letters of the epistolary, where they compare customs of foreign countries during their travels, saying, "It's not like in Germany," or "We Germans." Another letter provides further confirmation, sent to Maria Theresia Hagenauer, the wife of friend Johann Lorenz Hagenauer, by Leopold Mozart from Paris with the following address, to Mrs. Maria Theresia Hagenauer, Salzburg, in Bavaria. The religious influence in Salzburg was clearly evident in its architecture, given the presence of numerous churches and of the cathedral chapter made up of 24 canon priests. For centuries, the princedom was culturally and economically tied to Bavaria. It was only in 1816, after various vicissitudes, that the territory was assigned to Austria following a decision taken by the Vienna Congress. In the princedom, the prince-bishop had, like the pope in the church state, spiritual power as well as temporal power. The origins of the inauguration stem from a present monastery dating back to the turn of the 5th century, but the city began to develop after St. Rupert was transferred in the subsequent century. As the centuries passed, the city lived through many disputes for power, but transformed into something that gave it a medieval appearance. Dark and gray were the castles and the dominating hilltops, and the underlying city areas revealed distressed and dark streets. The architectural and cultural turning point of the city came about with the Prince-Bishop Wolf Dietrich von Rednau, 1559 to 1617, who was the nephew of Giovanni Angelo de' Medici, Pope Pius IV. It was Rednau, using harsh measures in Counter-Reformation, and who had cultural ties to Italy due to his formation as a youth in Rome, who planned the Baroque transformation in Italian style in Salzburg, which continued to be carried out by his successors. The ambition of turning Salzburg into a little Rome can be seen in the St. Cajetan Church, San Gaetano's Church, commissioned by the Italian architect Gaspare Zugalli, which evoked St. Peter's Basilica, to be followed by the creation of the Holy Stairs that evoked Rome's Scala Sancta at St. John in Laterano. Von Rednau renovated the Residenz, the city's palace, where he could live in comfort rather than the cold rooms of the castle, and administer the construction of the new Duomo by the architect Vincenzo Scamozzi from Vicenza, the same architect who designed the Teatro di Sabbionetta, theater in the style of the ancients, the first theater built in masonry in the modern age. He had most of the city's residential area demolished and rebuilt, inspired by Italian form and style, with large squares and pastel-colored houses which, without denying local tradition, evoked a southern appearance and character. The cultural tie with Italy was also demonstrated by the fact that in 1614, in Salzburg, the first opera outside the Italian borders was performed. Orpheus, very likely Monteverdi's, who had created it in 1607 for the Mantuan court of the Gonzagas, and had published the musical score in 1609. The personality of von Rednau, though, even with his undeniable merits, wasn't lacking in his opposing sides with his passion for art. From his predisposition for combat, he had a long dispute for control over the rock salt mines on the territory, which was the true source of its wealth, to an indulgence toward frivolous tendencies which were irrelevant to an ecclesiastical environment. He kept a mistress, Salome Alt, who repaid him with 15 children, for whom he built the Mirabel Palace with its splendid gardens. Various other princes succeeded von Rednau, bishops who completed the transformation of the little jewel of a city that it is today, and that we can still admire. Up until Sigismund III, Christoph von Schrattenbach, 1698 to 1771. Of noble lineage and of a cultured Roman education, he was a lover of the arts and had the services of Leopold Mozart and Johann Michael Haydn, brother of the more well-known Franz Joseph Haydn, who was the Kapellmeister in Salzburg, and had a musical impact on the early compositional works of Wolfgang Mozart. Schrattenbach was succeeded by Hieronymus Joseph Franz de Paula Coloredo von Walse und Melz, 1732 to 1812, who reigned the princedom from 1772 to 1803, when the dominion was secularized and entrusted first to Ferdinand of Habsburg, and then directly administered by Vienna, capital of the Habsburg Empire. Coloredo was an authoritarian, though a paternalistic follower of the Age of Enlightenment, and was a cultured patron of the arts, as well as an amateur violinist. The diffusion of certain Enlightenment ideals of the European princes was proven by the fact that Coloredo kept portraits of Rousseau and Voltaire in his studio. He had very clear ideas and well-delineated tastes, even if not avant-gardist for that epoch, regarding the music that he preferred in civil and religious situations of the princedom. At a certain point, in order to reduce expenses, he eliminated the theatrical activity that inspired Wolfgang as a composer. Coloredo's relative musical competence may explain his low appreciation of Leopold Mozart as a musician, possibly irritated by the insistent pressure of Leopold, who aspired to a promotion from Weisskapellmeister to a higher position. This never came to be, in any case, despite his stories of triumphant success that Leopold had certainly spread around the city in memory of the grand European tour of a few years previous. The young Amadeus, unruly and quarrelsome by nature, combined with a rebelliousness difficult to contain, who in the meantime had been hired as a musician at the archiepiscopal court and then as an organist, did not make himself welcome and earned a dismissal with the additionally famous kick in the seat of his pants by Count Carl Joseph Felix Arco, chamberlain to the archbishop. We will talk more about these episodes and many more anecdotes as we move through our Mozartian account through the rich epistolary available to us. So, during Mozart's era, what was life like on a social level in Salzburg? The little princely town, like all the other capitals of the many independent states and confederates of the empire, had at its center the prince and his court, which formed a crown, like the rings of water that form when a stone is thrown in the middle of a pond. Social circles that represented cultural and economic levels that went from the most superior as the ripples moved away from the center. The first and most central circle was made up of the highest local aristocracy, honored with titles and positions regarding the management of the princedom, spiritual with the canons of the Duomo, as well as temporal, which included positions in the various offices, and the public and private activities of the archbishop, grand chamberlain, council members, ministers, etc. In the outer circle, which operated on precise directions from the decisional magic circle, a multitude of functionaries who managed their own small power over subordinates and therefore had a certain social prestige linked to their role, the functionaries of the palace, the military hierarchy, the musicians with senior positions, kapellmeisters, concertmasters, composers for the court. Even farther away from the powerful, but important to the palace's economy, at least in part, were the middle and lower classes, artisans, merchants, and various professionals, who created business and offered services to those who had money. And then there was the common class who worked as servants, hard laborers, and those who lived hand to mouth. These people didn't have any rights or prospects for the future, and considered themselves lucky if they were able to manage to survive. Often, in fact, they were directed to the princely offices to plea for any task, willing to go upon request for any job, or to beg for unemployment aid, or support, or for tax-exempt status, something that Leopold Mozart did at one time regarding imported wine, or requesting permission to marry. Almost every aspect of the life of the common citizens was ruled and dominated by the will, and sometimes the whims, of the powerful. While it was true that many of the requests for assistance were granted, 20% of the population of Salzburg received something. It was usually less than what was requested. This permitted the prince to maintain a certain social equilibrium, allowing the population to believe that the commoners had no rights and that the princedom was being generous. Interesting facts on Salzburg. Here are a few interesting facts related to daily life in Salzburg, some of which were recounted in Nannerl's diary, which help us better understand that faraway epoch and the quotidian of the Mozart family. Flagellated in the town hall, when girls were discovered morally misbehaving regarding their sexual conduct, they were publicly whipped in the town hall and sent to a correctional home. On 11th August 1775, this happened to 7 maids. Grenadiers. When the archbishop traveled outside of the city, he was escorted by numerous grenade-throwing soldiers who were guards of honor and served to protect against potential attacks. Nannerl writes of 40 soldiers in her journal. The pardon. For the occasion of Holy Friday, the Confraternity Brotherhood of Trinity obtained the privilege to request the pardon for the death sentence of a mill worker who had killed a judicial officer, as recorded by Nannerl. Dangers in the beer taverns. A certain Mr. Stadler was asphyxiated in the cellar of the Stockhammer pub, which is still open for business in Salzburg today. Experiments in physics. At the University of Salzburg, while occasional lessons and experiments in physics were executed, persons of nobility of the city were allowed to participate. At times, these experiments were held in less rigorous locations, for example, at the Kugel pub, or in the town hall where these illustrative representations of physics occur during the market days by physicus Hoeg. We know nothing about Mr. Hoeg, except that during that epoch, together with the true scholars, they circulated around the fairs as a sort of itinerant medicine man, like Dr. Dulcamara in Donizetti's L'Elisir d'Amore, The Elixir of Love, using a few tricks to make ends meet by playing upon people's gullibility and the growing interest for science typical of the times. Scientific experiments, interesting facts, and social phenomenon. Among the simpler experiments that were fashionable during the mid-1700s, so much so as to be displayed in paintings and hung in households, were to demonstrate the necessity for living creatures' need of oxygen. The experiment was to place a small animal under a bell jar and use a specific pump that would extract the air while watching the animal die. All over Europe, interest in science spread rapidly, even among women. In Parisian parlors, groups of 20 to 25 people gathered to participate in chemistry, physics, and natural history courses. Novels and books on philosophy were substituted by physics and chemistry in women's parlors. Throughout Europe, newspapers published articles that combined science and poetry for women, suggestions on etiquette, news, astronomy, etc. There were also accidents and martyrs in the name of research for progress, such as J.P. de Rosier, chemist and physicist who gave lessons to the Parisian nobility and who went down in history as a key player with his hot air balloon and the first mortal flight accident in history. Anatomy also had its followers, such as the 18-year-old Contessa de Cogny, who during her journeys never traveled without a cadaver in a crate to execute demonstrations in dissecting. Soldiers and drilling. In a town like Salzburg, not particularly abundant in events for breaking up the monotony of everyday life, going to watch the soldiers practice their drilling exercises was an opportunity to get out of the house and create a diversion. Processions. There were solemn events in various moments of the liturgical year. Among these were the procession of the Corpus Christi, accompanied by the prince's cavalry, and open fire with the exception of the various stops effectuated in the Piazza del Duomo. Without a doubt, the liturgical festivities in Salzburg were celebrated with less cruelty compared to Paris, where for the feast of St. John, the King of France would ignite a bonfire in which cats and foxes were set on fire and thrown upon it. Suicide and insanity. Sadly, even in those times, there were desperate situations which were probably caused by misery or the unbearable cruelty of an abusive master. In Nannerl's journals, she writes about the suicide of a poor servant named Schlauka, who hung himself at 11:30 p.m. in his room. And then there was a certain von Amen, who appears to have lost his mind and was then hospitalized in the city, while another by the name of Endelbach died in the fortress where he had been incarcerated for disorderly intoxication. At the theater, Theater life in Salzburg was not based on any regular timetable, since there was not a resident theatrical company in the city. In exchange, when one reached the privileged period of the performances, the Carnival, for example, an enormous number of exhibitions were performed, with and without music and dancing. One example is during the period between 16th January 1783 and 12th February 1783. 11 different comedies were performed, alternating between the performances of serenades, an operetta, 3 French comedies, 2 all-night balls in the city hall, with 65 present at the first and 160 present at the second, as well as another 4 balls at the Carnival. Famous musicians just passing through. As in all of the European courts, many famous musicians who were experts in their instruments often passed through Salzburg, touring continuously among the most culturally and politically important hearts of the continent. Nannerl writes in her diary about the arrival in the city of the famous oboist virtuoso, Frederik Ramm, who joined the celebrated Mannheim Orchestra at the young age of 14 years old, appearing at the Salzburg court in 2 concerts before departure to the following stop of his tour in Munich. Day trips. The organization of day trips outside of the city were frequent during fair weather, on foot or by carriage. Among the most popular destinations were the Maria Plain Pilgrimage Basilica, the Münchberg, one of the 2 lower mountains overlooking Salzburg, from which emerged the Hohenzollern-Salzburg fortress and nunnery, and the Kapuzinerberg, the Capucines' cloister, named after the monastery upon which it is situated. Games, entertainment, and amusement. When friends got together in the Mozart household or at their friends' homes, they enjoyed playing games. Almost every day they were card games, most often tresette, a trick-taking card game, and tarok, tarot, as well as many other card games played with small bets of money. Another game enjoyed by many was darts, played with air guns, offering prizes for the winner, who was, though, obliged to pay for a round of beer for the group. There was also a popular game called Kegelspiel, ninepins, something similar to bowling. In 1783, we see the term lottery written in Nannerl's diary, which was probably a lottery game or something resembling bingo. The lottery, already diffused in various forms in other European countries, the game of the seminary, named after the ballot box used for its extraction, and the lottery of the old maid, named for a wedding dowry, became widespread during the second half of the 18th century in Austria. Wolfgang Mozart himself had probably brought the game to his friends in Salzburg from Vienna after his marriage to Constanze, where it is likely that he learned about it in Vienna, where he had lived for 2 years, and from where all things fashionable came before reaching Salzburg. In fact, there is no mention at all of the game in Nannerl's diary before this. Music at the Archbishop Prince's Court of Salzburg. In order to understand the dimensions of the aspect of music in a relatively small but wealthy court like that of Salzburg, we need to take into consideration the information related to an article from the Salzburg Institute of Music published at that time in a Berlin newspaper. The writer of the article was anonymous, but likely traceable to Leopold Mozart, given that his presentation is the longest and most detailed of all, not to mention that he corresponded regularly with the director of the newspaper. Approximately 100 musicians belonging to the Archiepiscopal Musical Choir were listed, among which about 20 bowed string instrumentalists, 2 keyboardists, about 10 woodwind and brass instrumentalists, not to mention the instrumentalists added for special occasions and celebrations, such as approximately 10 trumpeters and 2 percussionists. About 10 soloists composed of a full orchestra of sopranos, tenors, and basses, about 20 contraltos, falsettos, tenors, and basses in the chorus, and a children's choir composed of 15 boys were added to the instrumentalists. The quantity did not always correspond with the quality of the music. If we want to give credit to Wolfgang Mozart, as he wrote from Paris to his father on 9th July 1778, "One of the main reasons I can't stand Salzburg is due to the vulgar, miserable, and sloppy orchestra of the court. And this is possibly why our music is not appreciated and taken into consideration. If only things here were like in Mannheim, an orchestra with discipline. The English traveler Charles Burney, while not having been in Salzburg in person, but informed by his own sources in 1772, reports that the Archbishop Colloredo was a capable amateur violinist and was using all his means to improve his orchestra. He was noted, according to some, for his loud and crude playing, rather than for delicacy and perfection. The same source, who had been at the Mozart home, updated Burney on the status of the two former child prodigies. The young man, who amazed all of Europe during his childhood, continues to be a great master of his instrument. Nannerl, at this point in time, has reached all of her potential and does not show any further extraordinary gift. And lastly, an opinion on 16-year-old Wolfgang's talent, which should be compared to the enthusiastic words of Leopold in order to understand that not everyone had the same impression. If I were to evaluate the music that I heard, composed for orchestra by the young Mozart, I would consider him to be an example of precocious development, more astonishing than excellent. If the numbers quoted seem exaggerated, and quite possibly they were, considering the level of poverty in which its subjects lived, and in which their taxes were utilized by the court for its expenses, here we have another example in Germany in 1772. Mannheim, a small capital with a population of approximately 25,000 in 1776, as was Salzburg, which was the seat of the prince's electoral palatinate, as well as the most famous orchestra of its time. Charles Burney reports that there were nearly 100 musicians and 23 vocalists at the service of the prince, among which many were Italian, Roncaglio, Persarini, and Saporossi. The high regard in which the prince held the musicians, not especially common for that epoch, was clarified by his specific generosity. On the list of the 100 musicians, not all of them were actively engaged, some for old age, some for ill health. So the prince guaranteed all the musicians who were no longer able to work a good pension, as long as they resided in Mannheim, but would be compensated, though with a half salary, in the case that they should relocate back to their birthplace or elsewhere. Moreover, the advantages of the courtiers of the electoral palatinate did not end there, as was the summer relocation to the residence of Schwetzingen. His Highness was accompanied by 1,500 people, paying all of their travel, food, and accommodation expenses, while it is probably more accurate to say that the Mannheim citizens covered all costs. Another example, even more expensive and indicative of the social perception that the lower classes had regarding artistic expenses of the monarchy, Ludwigsburg, 1772, the new seat of the court of the Duchy of Württemberg, after its transfer from Stockholm. The Italian Niccolò Giomelli, 1714 to 1774, serving the Duke from 1754 as a composer and Kapellmeister, directed the theatrical seasons of the court, which were considered the most extravagant and lavish. The expenses for the theatrical and musical productions, though, were so exorbitant that they compounded upon the taxation level to the point that the citizens had to resort to the imperial diet, a convention formed by the emperor and by the most influential princedoms of the empire, in protest of what they considered excessive squandering at the expense of the community. The result of the protests was a reduction of 50% of the wages of the musicians and consequently an exodus of the best in the court, with the exception of the charge. In 1770, even Giomelli's contract was annulled. Regardless, in 1772, the orchestra of the Duke of Württemberg, which was under the direction of the Italian violinist Antonio Lolli, first violin soloist who in his previous years was so extraordinarily talented that he was able to increase his earnings from 700 florins to 2,000, could count on 18 violins, 6 violas, 3 violoncellos, 4 double basses, 4 oboes, 2 flutes, 3 horns, and 2 bassoons, for a total of 42 musicians, of which were added 2 organists. In addition to the musicians, we can also count the singers, almost all Italian, for the melodramma serio, 2 sopranos, two contraltos, two castrati, and for the opera buffa, three female voices and five male voices. 32 male and female dancers, not to mention instrument carriers, opera prompters, and copyists for the preparation of the scores to be distributed among the musicians. Here we also find a list of 90 retired artists. Burney also tells us of a peculiar piece of information, that the court of the Duke of Württemberg had 15 castrated singers at his disposal, as he had two Bolognese surgeons that were experts at the surgery that affected the timbre of the voice. The musicians of the Salzburg court. Knowing the musicians who gradually came later into the scene in the various roles at their service to the Salzburg court may help us understand who the Mozart family was dealing with, and possibly better comprehend why Leopold, after various initial career advancements, held his position definitively in the role of Weisskapellmeister. The names of these musicians can also be occasionally found in the Mozartian epistolary, which is why there could be useful information about them in order to better understand situations and relations that influenced the Mozart's life. When Leopold Mozart was hired in 1743 as a violinist in the orchestra of the Prince's Archbishop of Salzburg, at the musical apex of the city sat Johann Ernst Eberlin, with already 17 years of service as the court's organist, and then promoted to Kapellmeister in 1750, and Anton Cajetan Adelgasser, initially hired as a chorister, who was then replaced by Eberlin in the role of court organist. These two musicians, both originally from Bavaria, were, therefore, directly superior, and most certainly to him, besides aspiring to the post that they held being of higher importance and pay than his, lead to some profit in the connections of their compositions toward his advancement as a composer. Johann Ernst Eberlin, Yettingen, 1702, to Salzburg, 1762. Eberlin's musical education was quite similar to that of Leopold Mozart, of which he was also friend, teacher, and probably mentor in the musical court. In fact, like Leopold, he also studied at the Lyceum of the Jesuits of Augsburg, where he received his musical education, and later transferred to Salzburg to study law at the Benedictine University, and like Leopold, abandoned his studies after 2 years. Hired in 1727 as an organist, during the epoch of the Archbishop Firmian, who governed nearly 20,000 inhabitants of the region, of which practicing Protestants were forced to emigrate. In 1749, he obtained simultaneously the positions of court Kapellmeister and cathedral Kapellmeister, namely chorus conductor, and was responsible for the musical development for all of the ceremonies at the Salzburg Cathedral. Eberlin was an esteemed composer, and even Leopold Mozart had a high opinion of his music, which, though given their outdated style in comparison to the musical evolution of that epoch, were soon forgotten. His keyboard musical pieces, 9 toccatas and fugues for the organ, were requested by Wolfgang in 1782, while he was residing in Vienna, discovering the fugues of Bach, thanks to the evening spent at the Baron von Swieten home. Wolfgang's intention was probably to use them to deepen his study of the fugue, or possibly, as had already happened in the past, to claim them as his own, secretly requesting to have his father copy them in Salzburg, obtaining the goodwill of von Swieten, who was a great appraiser of Bach's polyphonic music. In a letter to his sister Nannerl, dated 20th April, he writes, "If our father has not yet had the operas of Eberlin copied, I would be happy, as I have already secretly received them and unfortunately have ascertained that they are too ordinary to deserve a position among Handel and Bach." Anton Cajetan Adelgasser, Insel, 1729, to Salzburg, 1777. After moving from his birthplace in Bavaria to Salzburg, Adelgasser became Eberlin's pupil, later marrying his daughter, and was the organist of the cathedral until his death. Wolfgang Mozart followed him as organist. He married 3 times in his lifetime. His last wife was the singer Maria Anna Fessemeyer, of which both Mozart father and son were witnesses at their wedding, given their friendship and their collaboration in the creation of the oratory Die Schuldigkeit des ersten Gebots, the duty of the first commandment. The composition, in three parts, beholds a 10-year-old Wolfgang Mozart compose the first, Michael Haydn the second, and Adelgasser the third. He died, astonishingly, of a heart attack while performing the aspiration of his life during his performance at the organ in Salzburg's cathedral. Giuseppe Francesco Lolli, Bologna, 1701, to Salzburg, 1778. Hired in 1722 as a tenor in the orchestra of the Salzburg court, Lolli became Vice-Kapellmeister in 1743 and then Kapellmeister in 1762. Leopold Mozart, who aspired to that very position, was embittered by the preference conceded to Lolli, so much so that he writes of his rival's compositions, "He has never written more than a few chamber oratorios and religious music." In 1772, due to old age, he was replaced as Kapellmeister by Domenico Fischietti. Johann Michael Haydn, 1736-1806. Younger brother, in age as well as musically, of the great Franz Joseph, followed his elder brother's footsteps, becoming, at the age of 8 years old, a choir boy in the chorus at St. Stephen's Cathedral in Vienna. He later studied violin, organ, and composition. As soon as he finished his studies, he was appointed Kapellmeister in Oradea, a Romanian city located in the northwest, where he was to gain experience. 5 years later, in 1762, he relocated to Salzburg to replace Leopold Mozart, who was no longer available for the position due to the first promotional journey to Vienna of his child prodigy, and then finally as Kapellmeister and concert conductor. Initial annual pay was 300 florins, a position that he held for 43 years, including the honor of free meals in the official dining hall. Leopold and Wolfgang Mozart never had such a privilege and were only allowed to eat at the table in the kitchen with the servants. Father and son obviously had frequent interactions with Michael Haydn, who represented a model for some of the compositions of Wolfgang's youth, since as a composer he had a considerably vast production in all types of music utilized in that epoch. Symphonies, concerts, serenades, trios, quartets, sonatas, sacred and profane vocal music. Some of Michael Haydn's works were cited in the Mozartian epistolary as transcribed, however not always authorized, and were utilized for educational purposes, as well as something to display to his two children. Even though they worked together on an almost daily basis, Leopold Mozart held a grudge against Michael Haydn, which we see in letters to Wolfgang, denigrating his higher-ranking superior with accusations of him being lazy, which was later retracted by his immense catalogue of compositions, and a drunkard. Similar opinions were surely expressed as gossip among the circle of friends of the family, and was quite likely that these rumors reached the ears of the archbishop, which certainly did not serve to favor his opinion of the envious Leopold. Domenico Fischietti, Naples, 1725 to Salzburg, 1810. Son of Kapellmeister and composer Giovanni Fischietti, after his musical studies in Naples under the tutelage of his father and then Francesco Durante, just to name a few, he made his debut in the same city with his first opera, Armindo, in 1742. In 1755, he moved to Venice, where the first thing he did was stage the opere buffe on the text of Carlo Goldoni with enormous success. After experience in Prague as the impresario of the theatrical Bustelli Company in 1764, he was appointed Kapellmeister in Dresden in 1766 after Johann Adolf Hasse, with an annual salary of 600 florins. Having lost his position at Dresden, he went to Vienna in 1772, where he met the Archbishop Colloredo of Salzburg, who, appreciating his musical talents, engaged him as composer for the cathedral choir and assistant to Kapellmeister Lolli and to Vice Leopold Mozart. From 1776 to 1783, he was Kapellmeister to the Salzburg court and cathedral, with an annual salary of 800 florins. Luigi Maria Baldassarre Gatti succeeded him as Kapellmeister. Luigi Maria Baldassare Gatti, 1740 to 1817. The musical formation of the abbot Gatti took place in Verona and Mantua, where he began his career as a tenor at the chapel of St. Barbara in Mantua, but soon became successful as a composer thanks to his opera Alessandro nelle Indie. In 1769, he was vice-capellmeister in the newly established Accademia Reale di Mantova, Virgilian Academy of Science and Arts, with a salary of 6 gold coins of 45 lire. On the occasion of his first trip to Mozart's Italy in 1770, he was able to listen to the young Wolfgang in Mantua at the highly acclaimed exhibition at the Teatro Scientifico, today known as the Teatro Bibbiena, named after its designer, and met the two Salzburg men. In 1778, he was engaged as vice-capellmeister to the court in Salzburg and was on good terms with the Mozarts, at least until February of 1783, when he was hired as capellmeister in Salzburg to the detriment of Leopold Mozart, who had coveted the position for years. In Nannerl's journal, Leopold vented his anger venomously upon one of Gatti's serenades exhibited in the theater, defining it as charming Italian music, more appropriate for the ears than the heart, since the harmonization with the expression of the lyrics and the true passion is less than satisfactory. In any case, Gatti was an abbot, and he would have had to imagine passion. Gatti was the last Kapellmeister of Salzburg due to the abolishment of the princedom, and the territory was integrated into the borders of the Habsburg Empire. Here is a summary pertaining to the musicians of the court of Salzburg during the period involving the Mozart family and the musical activity of the princedom. Prince Archbishop Leopold Antonio Eleuterio Firmian, from 1727 to 1744. Kapellmeister Matthias Sigismund Bichteler, until 1743. Karl Heinrich von Bibern, from 1743 to 1749. Court organist Johann Ernst Eberlin, from 1727, Leopold Mozart, 1737, arrival in Salzburg, 1740, assistant to the chamber and music for the court, Johann Baptist von Thurn Valsassina and Taxis, early compositions, 1743, engaged as fourth violinist in the court orchestra, Prince Archbishop Jakob Ernst von Liechtenstein Kastelkorn, from 1745 to 1747. Kapellmeister Johann Ernst Eberlin, from 1749 to 1762. Court organist Johann Ernst Eberlin, from 1727. Leopold Mozart, 1744. Added to his role of violinist, he was hired to teach violin and keyboard to the children in the cathedral choir. He married in 1747. Archbishop Prince Andreas Jakob von Dietrichstein, from 1747 to 1753. The Mozart family, 1751, Nannerl Mozart is born. Archbishop Prince Sigismund III Christoph von Schrattenbach, from 1753 to 1771. Kapellmeister Giuseppe Francesco Lolli and Johann Michael Haydn, from 1762. Court organist Anton Cajetan Adelgasser, from 1762. Leopold Mozart, 1756, published the violin school. Wolfgang is born. 1757, appointed court composer. 1758, promoted to second violin in the court orchestra. 1763, appointed vice kapellmeister. Wolfgang Mozart, 1769, appointed third master concert performer to the court without a salary. Archbishop Prince Hieronymus Joseph Franz de Paula Coloredo von Walse und Mels, from 1772 to 1803. Kapellmeister Domenico Fischietti, from 1772. Luigi Maria Baldassare Gatti, from 1783. Court organist Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, from 1777. Leopold Mozart, court composer with Kaspar Christelli and Ferdinand Seidel. Wolfgang Mozart. From 1772, he was violinist at the court orchestra without a salary, followed by concertmaster with a very low salary of 150 florins annually. In September of 1777, he left the position in order to travel to Munich and Paris. Upon his return in January 1779, he was appointed the position of court organist and concertmaster. In Vienna, April 1781, he resigned permanently from the services of Archbishop Colloredo. The Mozart family. We can begin with a snapshot of the epoch with the celebrated painting by Johann Nepomuk della Croce that represents the Mozart family in 1780 or 1781. It depicts Wolfgang and his sister Nannerl at the keyboard during a performance of a piece with four hands while their father Leopold poses nearby, listening with his violin ready to intervene. The oval-shaped portrait hanging on the wall portrays their mother, who had passed away in Paris 4 years earlier. And hanging on the right is Apollo, the Greek god of the arts, displayed with the instrument devoted to him, the chitarra. The Mozart family was formed on 21st November 1747, when the 28-year-old Leopold Mozart married the 27-year-old Anna Maria Pertl at the Salzburg Cathedral after a rather long courtship. They were reputedly a handsome couple and enjoyed a solid marriage over the years, as we learn from the family correspondence available to us. In one letter sent to his wife, Leopold Mozart, who was traveling with their son Wolfgang, writes, "Today is our wedding anniversary. If I'm not mistaken, 25 years have passed since we had the joyful idea to marry. The fact of the matter is that we had this idea many years prior. The best things in life come to those who wait." In that era, roles were well defined and customs and traditions were highly respected. The husband took care of all things related to finances and society. Leopold was extremely meticulous to the point of fanaticism, as we will see in his letters, while the wife looked after the household and children, maintaining relations with their circle of friends or people who were in some way useful to reach certain purposes. The Mozart couple had seven children, but only two survived. The fourth-born, Maria Anna, Nannerl, in 1751, and the seventh-born, Wolfgang, Wolf Earl, to family members, who came into the world in 1756. The mortality rate for childbirth in that epoch was a situation that was painfully accepted by parents who, for this reason, gave birth to many children. Wolfgang himself had six children, of which only two survived. In Nannerl's diary, which was written from 1775 to 1783, we learn that the Mozart family had a wide range of acquaintances with friends who visited them at their home, some on a daily basis, or who they visited in their friends' homes, as well as the students of Leopold and Nannerl. They passed their time together chatting and gossiping or playing cards, tresette, tarocchi, briscola, etc., or at range shooting, played with air-compressed guns always made with small wagers of money, or birilli, a game similar to bowling. The guests frequently stayed at the Mozart's home for meals, and likewise the Mozart family was often hosted at their friends' homes to dine. And naturally, there were many occasions to play music. To begin with, there were the music lessons. Leopold taught violin, while Nannerl taught the harpsichord at the Mozart residence or at the students' homes. But in the household, Mozart also played music with his circle of friends from Salzburg, many of whom belonged to the orchestra of the Archbishop Court. He also played with foreigners passing through the city, who were invited by Leopold, or brought to him by his circle of friends who regularly visited. Nannerl's friends would style her hair, accompany her for long walks along the city walls, which no longer exist today, participate in the almost daily religious receptions which were often accompanied by the music of the court composers, such as Eberlin, Adelgasser, Michael Haydn, and Wolfgang Mozart himself. Processions were another attraction for the people, especially those on solemn occasions when the Archbishop Prince would make an appearance, or, as on the occasion of the Feast of Corpus Christi, where they were accompanied in grand style by the Order of Chivalry, as was written in Nannerl's diary. Wolfgang couldn't resist making fun of the fact that on the occasion of a visit to the Hagenauer family, the previous owners of the Mozart house in Getreidegasse, he saw the horses crapping and dropped a lit candle on the procession. Things wouldn't have been complete without blasphemous distractions, such as the frequent participation of the Mozart family, even for many days in a row, of the comedic performances proposed by the theatrical companies that toured Salzburg and would stop over for a few weeks, where they offered various shows from their repertoire. In 1779, for example, Johann Böhm's theatrical company settled in Salzburg for the season, proposing over the course of the year about 10 encore performances, in the neighborhood of 60, according to Nannerl's diary, of a variety of comedies and ballets which were, in truth, judged to be very bad. There were also the musical academies and ballets, as well as the evenings of weekly ballroom dancing, mostly during the carnival at the town hall. Here is the musical program of an academy held on 18th March 1779. In Nannerl's diary, the 23-year-old Wolfgang sometimes wrote in his sister's journal with his characteristic gags, describing the academy as trendy crapademia. 1. A symphony, the Hofner Symphony, KV 385, composed by Wolfgang. 2. An Italian aria. 3. A trio with three voices by Antonio Salieri, imperial composer and kapellmeister during that epoch in Vienna. 4. A cello concerto by Josef Fiala, oboist, cellist, and friend of Mozart. 5. A vocal aria with oboe and harp. 6. An aria with trumpets, timpani, flutes, violas, bassoons, and basses, written by me, Wolfgang. 7. On Fossi's first finale from Perseguita Incognitata, Wolfgang's comically twisted title of the opera. The correct title by the composer Pasquale Anfossi's opera is Incognita Perseguitata. 8. Out of mere compassion did we let Cercarelli sing a rondo. Cercarelli was a Castro and family friend who served the Salzburg court, and for whom Wolfgang wrote an aria and an acting part. 9. In conclusion, we performed in the entire city of Milan, nota bene, with trumpets and timpani. Moreover, on special occasions, there were other forms of entertainment, such as fireworks in the summer equitation school. Another fashionable activity during the mid-18th century, also documented as a pastime in the Mozart household, was the silhouette, a portrait technique that traced the outline of a person or object and coloring the entire subject in black. This was achieved by hanging a white cloth in front of the subject while it remained backlit, highlighting the outline. Among these activities, with the exception of brief lessons nearly every day, there were, of course, the responsibilities at the court that weren't particularly demanding for concerts or various tasks, such as Leopold's job tuning the piano of the Archbishop's summer residence at the Mirabell Palace. Sometimes walks were taken in the gardens of the Mirabell Palace, in the newer part of the city on the other side of the river. Alternatively, there were excursions outside of the city walls, such as the visit in 1780 to the salt refinery and San Zeno. Remember that rock salt was the principal source of wealth in the region, of which is derived the name of the city of Salzburg, the Castle of Salt, and the Salzach River, the Passage of Salt. One last interesting fact regarding the Mozart family is the ciphered code that Leopold and his wife used to avoid the curiosity of censorship. During that epoch, letters and correspondence were often opened and read to monitor the subject's thoughts and ideas in order to avoid conspiracies. The letters that Leopold wrote were meant to circulate around Salzburg to express recognition of the musical feats that were accomplished in the various courts. Consequently, the secret code was used to communicate with his wife the occasions in which there were lies present in their correspondence to be fed to the archbishop. The most glaring examples we find in the letters from Milan, sent over the course of Leopold and Wolfgang's third and final Italian journey, in which he complains of a terrible pain in his arms and legs that kept him from departing for their return to Salzburg. In truth, he was procrastinating in order to find out the result of his contacts with Peter Leopold of Habsburg-Lorraine, Grand Duke of Tuscany, regarding Wolfgang being hired by the Florentine court, which turned out to be unsuccessful. Leopold was, unfortunately, obliged to return to Salzburg with his tail between his legs, his great Italian dream vanished. Looking back at the coded language, it was nothing particularly complex, and if a censor were to have gone to the trouble of deciphering it, they would have probably figured it out. Besides, it appears that none of the letters with coded parts were chanced upon by the monitors because, if they had been, the censor would have surely been curious to know which secrets might have been revealed in these senseless sentences included in letters that were otherwise easily comprehensible. And the methods for saying it were surely not lacking. So here is the little Mozart family secret. Substitute the vowels of some of the words with consonants. A equals M, E equals L, I equals F, O equals S, U equals H. Instead of Milano, they would have written Muffelmans. Part 1, continued. Wolfgang's mother, Anna Maria Walburga Pertl, 1720-1778, was born in St. Gilgen, a small village situated 545 meters above sea level on the banks of Lake Wolfgangsee, approximately 30 kilometers from Salzburg, the region's capital. It lies in a pleasant area and was enriched by small alpine lakes. In that epoch, there were just a handful of homes inhabited by farmers. Anna Maria's father, Wolfgang Nicholas Pertl, married to Euphrosina Puxbaum, the daughter and widower of two musicians of the church, completed his law studies and began a promising career as a state official in Salzburg, Vienna, and Graz. However, an incapacitating disease forced him to accept a lesser job as vice superintendent at Hüttenstein, a town near St. Gilgen, with a reduced annual salary of 250 florins. Taking into consideration the situation, imagine that today the town has little more than 3,000 inhabitants divided into seven districts, and at that time the population was much lower. Such a position wouldn't be particularly honorary, let alone well paid. At her father's death in 1724, the family lived in serious poverty with debts of more than 1,000 florins, causing their assets to be repossessed. This situation forced the wife to make the decision to return to the family's place of origin in Salzburg with two small children, one of whom died shortly after. Here, they lived a life of misery, managing to survive only thanks to a town welfare payment and minimal domestic jobs for other families. Therefore, we can assume that Anna Maria and Leopold's first meeting surely occurred in Salzburg. The cultural habits of farm life acquired in St. Gilgen and the environment of the impoverished in Salzburg must have certainly impacted Anna Maria's formation, which highlights, as sources tell us, a certain spontaneous and simple zest for life, combined with an enjoyment for crude banter, even to the point of being exceedingly vulgar. These traits were passed on to her son Wolfgang, as well as her poetic gift of rhyming all words related to the digestive and intestinal tract. Following are a few fragments of a rhyming composition, in German, sent by the 22-year-old Amadeus to his mother on 31st January 1778. They are also from people who carry crap in their belly, but who let it out before as well as after the revelry. They pass gas all night long in such a way as to resonate valiantly. As of now, we have left more than 8 days ago, and we have already shit in huge quantities. In all fairness, it should be stated that their father was not immune to the same literary pinnacles, at least as far as the same vulgarity among members of the family. Let us now look further into Anna Maria's colorful eloquence. Following is one of the most famous examples, a segment of a letter that the 53-year-old Mrs. Mozart sent from Munich to her husband Leopold, who had remained in Salzburg. "Goodbye, my darling," the original in Italian. "Be well. Into your mouth your arse you'll shove. I hope you sleep well, but first shit in the bed until it explodes. It's already past 1 o'clock. Now you can make a rhyme." Munich, 26 September 1777. The translation from the German, besides the explicit reference, doesn't allow us to understand the playful tone given that the text is in rhyming couplet and ends with a riddle of a fecal nature. This very same poem was later partially used by Wolfgang in the lyrics to one of the canons composed around 1788 in Vienna for the amusement of his friends. "Bona nox, beast a rechte ox." "Good night, you are a true ox," in four voices a cappella. Endowed with a limited culture, which was not uncommon among most of the population of that epoch, especially amidst the women, Anna Maria always possessed a subordinate role toward her husband as well as her son. as was demonstrated during the journey to Paris, which, as we will see, proved fatal for her, during which she remained passive to the indications from her husband in Salzburg and the differing aspirations of Wolfgang. She didn't speak any language except her own Salzburg German. In fact, during the European journeys carried out by the family, she associated only with German expatriates at public or business functions. We can discern a pleasant disposition. However, as far as culture and knowing her station in society, even with later attendance at the European courts, which had most certainly helped refine her, she was lacking. Here is an example of her ungrammatical way of expressing herself in writing, and I do believe that her speech was similar. I hope that you and Nanerl is well. What is my Bimperl up to? The family dog. It's been a while since I've not heard nothing about him. Letter from Mannheim to her husband, 31st October, 1777, as quoted by W. Hildesheimer. Though she did have the opportunity to refine her ways through her initial association with her circle of Salzburg friends of the family, the smaller local nobility, as well as the well-to-do high society, and later with some of the principal European courts, thanks to the exhibitions of the two child prodigy children. Wolfgang's sister, Maria Anna Walburga Ignacia Mozart, 1751-1829. Wolfgang's sister, 5 years his elder, also had a musical formation that led her to become a very accomplished harpsichordist and pianist. Thanks to the Mozartian correspondence, we know that in the family she was usually called by the affectionate nickname of Nanerl, Naninna Anetta. Her father began her musical formation at age 7, teaching her to play the harp and forte piano, as well as voice lessons. While she was very close to her younger brother, with whom she undertook the first long European journeys in the role of one of the prodigious children, she was, however, taken less seriously by her father than her brother. The reasons for this attitude, seen through modern eyes as certainly discriminatory, were at least two. As 5 years older than Wolfgang, Maria Anna inspired less of an impression as a child prodigy, and consequently her career was destined to be shorter term. Evidence of the favored treatment that their father used toward his son, and, as can be observed today, and which does not do Leopold Mozart honor, concerns two cases of illness and recovery. In November 1765, while returning from London on their first great journey that the entire family had embarked upon, Nanerl fell ill in Holland of a pulmonary disease that was so serious as to have her last rites given in danger of death. Fortunately, she recovered, and Leopold then wrote to his trusted friend Hagenauer to have 6 masses celebrated in thanks at the various churches of Salzburg. The following month, again in Holland, Wolfgang fell ill with a sort of typhoid fever, and after his recovery, Leopold ordered 9 masses of thanks to be celebrated, 3 more than those dedicated for the recovery of his daughter. We can say that Leopold Mozart concentrated his investment of time, energy, and expectations upon his son, younger and possibly more gifted. Who knows if Nanerl would have contributed the same results as her brother if she had been as sustained and supported as him. In a letter from Wolfgang to his sister, we understand that she too was an active composer, but the correspondence of Leopold makes no mention of any compositions or creative activity of his daughter, which in any case were never attained. The artistic creative level of Nanerl remains, at present, an unresolved mystery. The second reason for the preferential treatment typical of that epoch had much to do with being a female. In that era, it was a common and undisputed school of thought that females were inferior, and Leopold Mozart was no different in this way. In a letter dated 12 February 1756 to the publisher Lotter of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.